What is up, my ninjas? I'm Strident, and welcome to another episode of Joe Talk War Stories. This is episode 5, and today I'm bringing something special for you guys. It was special for me, to be honest. I don't know if you guys know it or not, but I'm a huge fan of G.I. Joe Berg. It's a team of 3 guys, sometimes 4, and they just embody the kind of love for G.I. Joe that the line needs in order for it to evolve and grow and get better and better. It's kind of like the way I feel about Rise of Cobra and Pursuit of Cobra. This is how they feel about almost the entire vintage line. And, you know, and aspects of the modern era as well. So today I got a chance to talk with them. We've been trying to meet up. They're in South Africa, as you know, in Johannesburg, South Africa. And we've been trying to link up, but the time difference, it's like an 8-hour difference. So when I'm getting off work, they're about to get ready to go to sleep, you know what I mean, and vice versa. So having an adopted sister that lives in Kenya, I'm a little bit familiar with it, and we juggled the time difference, and we managed to do so today. And we got to sit down and talk about a little bit about different videos and different ideas, mainly, you know, stuff I mentioned in my video about what I'd do with G.I. Joe if I ran the brand. And, you know, everybody gives their 2 cents and whatnot. And it was just a nice conversation. It was a nice reaffirming of why I'm such a fan of these guys and why I'm such a fan of G.I. Joe and why more of us need to come together to speak the right kind of speak so that Hasbro gets the right message instead of just the pure consumer message. But anyway, grab something to drink. You know the drill. Here we go.
This evening is pretty free form, but there are a few, high points that we'd like to touch on.
Yeah.
You always have the best ideas when it comes to what Hasbro should be doing with G.I. Joe. That's definitely one. And another one is something that you got a hold of me straight after you watched Jim Godfrey's customs unboxing on our channel. And you asked me, so Stephen, have you finally been won over to the modern era style G.I. Joes? Because you were fawning over those customs so hard.
Yeah.
Like, how did the vintage possibly hold a candle to that?
Yeah.
And I remained, to coin the phrase, resolute,
exactly.
I suppose, in my vintage, like, purism, I guess.
Yeah, true.
So maybe we should get the ball rolling with that, because on the one hand, I mean, Strident, you are a hugely outspoken when it comes to promoting the modern era style of construction and all the amazing things that they've achieved with that that style, and, you know, really making the best action figures ever made. I appreciate them, sure. Yeah. But I'm not going to be swayed from my vintage collecting pursuits. And then Paul is right down the middle, Mr. I just want everything. no restraint, no holds barred kind of guy.
Yeah.
So
if it says G.I. Joe, I buy it. Is that what you're trying to say?
Pretty much. You are led by your passions, sir, and it's a good thing.
Yeah.
But not when you're, I suppose, trying to juggle, I don't know, financial. Priorities.
I feel for your wallet.
Listen, I gotta say, like, it brings me a lot of happiness and sadness at the fact that Sideshow doesn't do G.I. Joe anymore.
Oh yeah,
it's those happiness awesome. In the form of not having to stress so much because those things were expensive. Damn. Mm-hmm.
Oh yeah, they look
and
good,
shipping
though.
Them was even more expensive.
Oh yeah,
double damn.
I know, it's crazy.
Yeah, like, Paul, you could have had a Defiant 3 times over.
That's true.
Yes, instead of your Sideshow collection.
That's very true.
I love my Sideshow collection, though. They're sexy.
Yeah, there's some awesome figures. They're awesome figures. I mean, they kind of give you that, the middle ground between the 100% modern era, you know, styling, but they still reflected the aesthetics of the vintage figures. You know, like, there was no mistaking when you see General Hawk with his bomber jacket and his, you know, his helmet, his battle helmet and whatnot, you know it's him with the goggles and everything, even though the style is still more current. You know what I'm saying? And I dug that
General
a lot.
General Hawk is a bit of a cop-out one to mention because, like, they went with the vintage style on that figure. one of the figures that was always for me more sort of on the borderline was Rock and Roll.
Yeah,
but he's one of Paul's favorites.
Yeah, me too.
And yet, like, he doesn't scream version one vintage or version two.
Yep.
It's kind of his own thing.
Yeah.
Screams Rock and Roll.
Yeah, well,
with
I
the
guess
do-rag.
In some way you could say he is, it's like, because he's wearing fatigues, basic fatigues. I mean, they happen to be camo, hence the whole, like, a jungle setting or something. Maybe that's where he's fighting. But, yeah, overall, I mean, he's got the bandolier, right? The double bandolier of, you know, ammunition. He's got they added a lot of more real world stuff to him, but he's got a backpack just like the original one. Rock and Roll version one, not straight arm, but, you know, swivel arm. That was the first G.I. Joe I ever got.
Sure.
So he's always been one of my favorites, him. And I had version two. I'm trying to get another one of the vintage version two. I love that figure. Yeah, it kind of feels like, you know, they did a good job updating things. I mean, if you stand him next to his vintage, you're right. He doesn't 100% look like it, but there's callbacks to him, you know?
Yeah. I just love all the little surfer. I like all the sort of
Cobra Don't Surf.
Yep, Cobra Don't Surf and Locals Only, and I love that stuff, man. It's really cool.
Yeah, the Viper looks really awesome too. The one that blew me away the most of the
bunch. That Viper is beautiful.
No, and feel free to just, like, I don't care if you guys jump in and cut. This is kind of how our conversations are. We're all like, oh my god. We just jump in. You know what I mean? So yeah, don't feel bad. But that one was awesome. And Falcon, for some reason, just, I don't know why he stood out to me. I like the way he looks, because I never thought very much of the character. I hated Falcon growing up. But seeing that figure, I'm like, damn, he looks official. He looks more, you know, rugged, and, like, he doesn't look like a screw up. You know,
I have a theory when it comes to Falcon.
What's the theory?
And it goes back to 87. Like, the original figure, the card art speaks volumes in terms of character, but the figure doesn't convey that.
Yeah.
He has a kind of a doe-eyed, blank expression. You know, Green Berets, at least how the file card seems to paint them, were the kind of troops that really sort of enter a sort of area of operations, and they become integrated into the sort of indigenous world. They train the locals. They act like a militia. They are, for all intents and purposes, like, your sort of deep, deep operatives who are in country, you know, living off the land with no supports. So the figure just looked too clean cut.
Oh, yeah, I agree.
And too, like, blank slate to really give you that sense.
Flash forward
to what Sideshow did with him, and all of a sudden you've got, like, 1 week stubble. he looks like he's just kind of, like, waded through a stagnant pool somewhere and just gotten rid of his leeches. I mean, he is in country, and he is hardcore, you know, missing an action kind of callback there. So, I mean, when I saw the Sideshow figure, I was like, yes, that makes sense.
Yep.
That's Falcon. At least that's the Falcon that I imagine when I read the file card.
Exactly.
Yeah.
And that's always the purest distillation of the characters to me.
But wasn't
what
that
does
always,
it say in their little biog?
Wasn't that always a
that's
problem?
That's your point of departure.
Like, with a lot of the vintage figures was, like, the I won't say a lot, but there are a couple, more than a couple, but there's, like, a bunch of figures that the file card says one thing. When you look at the figure, it's like, nah, that can't be that guy. No. Like, as if when they imagined the character, they had something else in mind. Then the cartoon came along and they were like, okay, let's simplify. Or maybe vice versa. You know what I mean?
Give us an example, man. Please, let's play this game.
Characters like Bazooka. That one always bothered me. He didn't seem
soft
like an
target.
Idiot. He didn't seem like an idiot. You know what I mean? And then you read you watch him in the cartoon, and there's a different character. You see the file card, it's like a different character. You see the figure, he kind of looks in between. He doesn't look hardcore and smart and, like, quick thinking. He just looks kind of blah as character-wise, you know what I mean? Like, he could go either way. Trying to think of some other ones, because I don't have these cards.
I listened to the Dead Ringer for me in that regard as well.
Mm-hmm.
Spearhead, as in Spearhead and Max, because... Uh-huh. When you read Spearhead's file card, it's all about how He's like a traveling salesman or whatever, and he's sort of jaded with things.
Uh-huh.
But okay, aside from the serious orange camo and whatever, he's pretty hardcore. I mean, he's not, you know what I mean?
Yeah.
It doesn't seem like the kind of guy that had that job and then decided to go into the military. You know what I mean? Like,
points to Paul for the obscure pick.
Yeah.
But I guess we've got a place for every single G.I. Joe. I mean, some people are fans of the Battle Force 2000.
I was going to bring them up. I was going to say, strangely enough, you guys mentioned a lot of this during your Battle Force 2000 talk.
That was... Yep. It's a crazy, crazy world. And there are all kinds of people making it up. But we all love this thing, man. We share it. It's in us. To get back to Bazooka, we were doing a rewatch of old cartoon eps. We did the Mass Device. We did a commentary on that.
Uh-huh.
And the DVD collection has a bunch of Ron Friedman retrospectives.
Uh-huh.
And his style of making sense of all these characters was to try and almost write a family sitcom. Like, you've got the weird, really eccentric uncle.
Yeah.
I guess like that's Gung Ho.
Yeah.
You know, you've got the dashing, like, father figure that's Duke. I guess when it came to Bazooka, Ron's way of making sense of how this guy fits in was he's like the dimwit. Every family's got one, you know. You got
paint.
Whether it's your aunt who's just a few. Well, yeah. Okay, so, I mean, the point is, like, this is just a sort of, I suppose, a writer's shorthand to try and understand who these people are. And the similar story with making Torpedo extremely gregarious and friendly and, like, easygoing. Hey, you know, the island Torpedo! Boy is just, like,
everybody was
the cool cousin who likes to surf and, you know, gets along with everybody, but which is a complete 180 from his file card.
Exactly.
You can't say it enough.
Exactly.
Yeah.
And
then the irony there being that you would think that, oh, okay, cool, Torpedo and Deep Six, you know, they like both underwater specialists, they should hang out together. No. There's two people that shouldn't be together.
Exactly.
Because they're volatile. Mm-hmm. You know, they've got volatile personalities. Yeah.
Allow me to put this train back on the tracks, gentlemen. Vintage, modern era.
Uh-huh.
My opening remark, I guess, I mean, this is going to be a subjective discussion anyways. No one's trying to sway anyone's opinion either way. I suppose we're just trying to discuss our viewpoints.
Yeah.
And maybe the listeners out there, our friends, our, you know, our followers would find themselves somewhere on this scale. Mm-hmm. But for me, I don't think I ever stopped collecting since my very first G.I. Joe. Not a year has gone by when I didn't try and find Joes. I mean, there was the drought from 94, but then I just started hitting flea markets and going to old dusty toy shops. And you know, my search intensified because for a while there was treasure to be had, a lot of back stock of old Joes. I mean, typically anything that didn't sell well in the States was then polluting the European markets. And anything that didn't sell well in Europe and the United Kingdom wound up here.
Yep.
So we were getting Joes well into 96, 97. And then things started drying up. But then 2 years later, hey, the miracle that is eBay arrived. And I remember my first Joe on eBay was Lady J.
Cool.
I didn't have a Lady J. And all of a sudden, bam, I had a free female protagonist and all was well in the world. I gave her an Uzi and a 45 and she was badass. Because no one wants that stupid spear gun on the fucking camera. Whatever. Like, garbage accessories. I'm sorry. So, yeah, she was too rad. Jumping out of helicopters and saving the day.
Yeah.
And that just, from then, I mean, it galvanized my love for the O-ring construction. Sure, I flirted with the modern era quite a bit. 25th anniversary, something that was, I mean, it had to happen.
Yeah.
The new sculpt era came and went. And that didn't sway me off of the original O-ring style guys. I was like, okay, I'll buy a few of these T-crotch fellas, but I certainly hope G.I. Joe doesn't go this way. Mercifully, it didn't.
What about the I'm sorry to cut you off. What about the new
Sigma 6?
No, not Sigma 6. Like, I wasn't a big fan of that either.
Era.
But new sculpt era stuff that had the O-ring construction, because you know they did eventually kind of switch. Like the early figures had the
useful. They were useful for a time because all of a sudden we had Joes and Cobras that had zero problems accepting any kind of weaponry. So the really gummy large hands. Were a revolution for me because I suppose I was still young enough to have really involved G.I. Joe sort of games.
Yeah.
Me and my two friends, we were kind of young teens, and you know, while no one was watching, we would get our Joes out and have some pretty involved plot lines, as involved as one could get as a young teen. I mean, it's not same kid here. Stuff, and it's inspired by what you're seeing in films and stuff. I mean, exactly. There was a huge kind of. We basically aped the Matrix big time for a while. And the new sculpt Joes were very instrumental in that.
Yeah.
I remember my friend, he had like a quad bike from the Chap May toy line, which he then used blue tack. In this country, we call it press stick. And it's not blue, it's gray, whatever. And he just stuck like every weapon that he had a strong affinity for. He just stuck it to this quad bike, so you had like, you know, just like in the Matrix, he could just like pick up a gun off his personal vehicle, you know, shoot it dry, toss it aside, pick another one up, rat-a-tat-a-tat, goes for the shotgun, rocket launcher,
wow,
you know, throw some hand grenades, and he used I think it was a 2003 beachhead with a blowtorch head.
Wow.
That was a sort of lazy boy custom given this blonde shaven head, beachhead style character.
Wow. Mm.
And he was called Echo Plissken.
Wow.
I mean, that's where awesome. Do we pull these names out of? So yeah, it had its time in the sun, but like pretty soon the body proportions started bugging me, and it kind of looked weird next to the traditional O-ringers, the vintage ones at least.
Yeah.
And not to mention the fact that every once in every while, it mixed into the new sculpts era stuff, there were vintage style figures that had the more forgiving plastic. Mm-hmm. And those guys I gravitated towards immediately. Those were like the best Joes ever because, you know, you could put anything in their hands and they meshed well with the vintage guys and the vehicles.
Yeah.
The thumb stayed, yeah.
I feel like I've done a little retrospective on my collecting habits.
See, that's why I was telling you
picked
you need
up
to do
a lot of the modern era stuff. Yeah. But I capped that off because I was like, I have priorities. And in all my years of collecting, I still do not have a complete vintage collection.
Yeah.
I mean, it is a challenge when you are at the southernmost tip of Africa. I don't want to hop on the issue, but like every single Joe that is shipped here, you're paying for twice, essentially. So it kind of puts a brake on when you can binge, how much you can binge on. And in that regard, this podcast has been huge for G.I. Joe, well, for the members of G.I. Joeberg, because it's opened its doors to a lot of generosity, folks overseas who have given us huge helping hands in filling holes, in getting really, really cool stuff. I am so excited about a very, very recent, I don't even call it recent, forthcoming arrival, because the collection slip hasn't arrived yet, but it's in the country. It's in my nearby post office. But G.I. Joeberg is getting a very, very spectacular item in the mail shortly.
Cool. See, this is why I was telling you should do a video about why you collect and what has kept you collecting for so long, specifically.
Are we doing that now?
Yeah, pretty much. I mean, but that's why I mentioned it, you know, when we were talking earlier, because it's one of those
things.
Because
my life would be pointless without this stuff. You know what? I'm living in a town right now, working in a town, which I believe firmly makes people miserable, and that's because
that's my town.
People in this town, this city, have prioritized the acquisition of wealth, they've put their career over and above lifestyle, because this town was built for business.
That's what it's
Johannesburg.
Saying. Yeah.
It wouldn't have existed unless they found gold here.
Yeah. Yeah.
And that just set the precedent for a society that structures itself around material gain. Boy, oh boy, am I glad I have something else getting me out of bed in the morning. It's material loss.
Yeah.
Material loss on these delightful playthings that, like, they're so steeped in nostalgia. I can't pick up a jar and not be transported to the first time I ever played with this guy.
Yeah.
Like, in my hands right now, I have Talking Battle Commander's Hawk. And boy, he's a doozy.
Yeah.
I remember when my best friend got this guy, and we all sort of like, ooh, he's the general. Shit, he's the general. We, you know, like, well, we've got to protect this guy. He is gold dust.
He's important.
Literally.
Yeah.
I mean, he has this huge, hulking, like, irremovable backpack made of gold.
That's all I remember that about guy that
guy's so bling. He's so dope. He's so gangster.
Dude, I'll be like 2 seconds. I just want to just check on a sound I heard.
Okay.
Oh, another problem with Johannesburg. It makes people paranoid because why there are folks out there just wanting to break into your house and steal your shit.
Yeah, Kenya is the same rough way. My sister's always talking about that. And they've had bikes stolen. They've had TV stolen right out of the house, all kinds of stuff. So, yeah.
Yeah, man. Africa, baby. There's desperation everywhere, man.
That's how
it is, unfortunately.
Honestly, over here, we have thugs who don't understand how to use guns. So at night, we hear, you know, semi-automatic fire. I won't say regularly, but fairly regularly, like kind of in the distance. But, you know, it's never followed by any sirens or anything because nobody gets hit because they don't know what they're doing. And I used to work at some crisis shelters, especially ones that were aimed towards youth. And I think only one time did we ever have a kid show up after someone was effectively shot. I mean, it's still bad, but, you know, at least it wasn't worse. But typically in this city, it seems like people love to shoot, but they don't understand how to hit things, you know? So I guess that's a good, you know.
It's a blessing, yeah.
Exactly, that's a good thing. But, yeah, I don't know. For me, with the Joes, I was really into the vintage ones at the time, but I never had many Joes. We couldn't find them. Like, we'd find vehicles, but they were always, like, my mom would be like, no, save that for your birthday, you know? Get it for your birthday because it's more expensive. Or at least the ones I wanted. The only vehicle I remember having as a kid was the Night Force. Was it called the Night Striker? It was the Night Force Killer Whale.
Oh, beautiful. Yeah.
I love that thing, man. It was awesome. And that was the only vehicle I had, but it was enough because I didn't have a ton of Joes. So we could just do all kinds of craziness with it, you know? But I could never find enough Joes to really have a collection. But I did have a friend growing up who had everything. Like, his dad was, like, super awesome in that regard, where he just, they had the catalog, they had the checklists, and literally he had everything. All the mail-away figures, the flag, everything. He had it. So I'd go over to his house and play with all his stuff, and it was cool, you know, for a while. And this was from, like, kindergarten to, like...
But I don't follow, man. Like you say, you couldn't find it. Where was that kid shopping?
That's what I'm saying.
Or did he have parents that were, like, you know, out of town all the time and hitting the big centers?
Possibly.
You couldn't miss.
I think between him and the mom and the dad, it was kind of like that because they weren't home a lot. We were always home with his older sister. She watched us and we would just be playing. And it was like, you know, that seemed to be the routine. So maybe it was one of those things. They travel a lot. So they would go places, find stuff, bring it back. And, you know, that was, you know, their way. But
not just any stuff either.
Yeah.
The flag.
Like the flag.
Out loud.
I couldn't believe that. Jeez. When he got the flag, I was like, are you serious? Because he told me when we were in first grade. And he told me, we were in first grade. And he told me about it. And I'm like, are you serious? The flag? Like the whole thing? Yep. He showed me it. We both just stared at it. We didn't even play with it that first day. We just looked at it like, wow. Because the thing was huge. We were little guys too. So it was huge. We couldn't really do anything.
Even begin to imagine the impact that a toy like that would have on a child at
exactly.
the time.
Exactly.
My knowledge of G.I. Joe extended to not even the cartoons, a few scrappy samplings of the American Real American Hero comic book, the Marvel one, and a 1990 and 1991 European catalog. Now, the European catalogs didn't even have the complete waves.
No.
They had a sort of a, you know, a mishmash of various different waves. They had a lot of the 1988 American releases, then mixed in with 89 stuff, and then some 1990 stuff like this Sky Patrol.
Yeah.
And just those two documents alone were enough to captivate me.
Yep.
I used to just pore over them on the backseat of the car for hours and hours, just fantasizing about these vehicles. Like, wow, they actually made that. That looks so cool. I would fawn over the Tiger Fly, which is the Tiger Force repaint of the Dragonfly. And immediately I was like, but that looks like a model kit. That looks so real.
Yeah.
I can't believe that. Like, that just blows everything else out of the water. I mean, this stuff is amazing.
Yeah, it was.
Like,
it was.
Flash forward a couple of years, imagine my surprise when I realized the Tomahawk wasn't just something they made up for the comic book.
Yeah.
It actually exists.
It exists.
There is a toy of it. Steven, get this toy now.
That was one of the cool things,
waste
too.
Waste no time. Hit buy.
For us, what was cool is my uncle worked on the Intrepid. And
oh, brilliant.
So we got to see a lot of the real world versions of these things. And I saw them before I was able to get the Joes, you know, the G.I. Joe stuff. So, you know, we'd see air shows and stuff, and then we'd be like, man, you know, we want the planes the Blue Angels are flying in. Or we'd see, you know, the Chinook helicopter, like, demos that they would do, showing how it can land backwards and take off backwards and blah, 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 and all the craziness. And so we always wanted that stuff. I mean, I didn't ever get a Chinook until, like, 5 or 6 years ago because the closest thing to the Chinook was the Tomahawk. And those, before the, 50th anniversary, those were pretty expensive, you know, if you're buying the vintage ones. But,
yeah, they were very pricey, I remember.
Yeah.
I think I recall paying, like, $80 for mine back in 2004.
Wow.
That seemed like a lot of money.
Yeah, in comparison, though, right now, and you had that shipped to you? Or did you buy it in Joburg?
I had it shipped to me. No, $80 covered the toy, not the shipping.
Oh, wow.
But that was quite a shipment. I mean, I bought the Tomahawk for myself, and I bought the Killer Whale for Rob.
Oh, cool.
Our third South African member.
Uh-huh.
And that was quite a time to be alive, man.
I could imagine.
After having just learned of these toys' existence,
uh-huh,
to then have bought them and had them shipped out to me. Oh, it was a good day. The very next shipment to arrive was a Night Raven and a Sky Striker. I mean,
wow.
Geez. My G.I. Joe, I suppose, renaissance came pretty late, but it was great.
Well, mine, so with me, I started back in the day. I had like a handful of Joes. The first Joe I got was Rock and Roll. I want to say the second one I got was Fast Draw. I think that's, Fast Draw. It was a long time in between, too. I got either Storm Shadow or Snake Eyes at some point, and they broke quickly because we played with them way too much. And then it was a long time before I got anything else. Then next, I got Rock and Roll and Zarana and the, you know, the Deke Cobra Commander with the, you know, the armored suit and all that.
Battle Armored Cobra Commander, yeah.
Yeah, and then I got, later on, I got a Nemesis Enforcer figure. I remember getting Slaughter's Marauders at some point, but I didn't have Sergeant Slaughter. Then Taurus broke, and then I got Sergeant Slaughter. But I never had them all at the same time, so I would try to get them, and then I got kind of frustrated because our Toys R Us just, it never seemed like they had them when I could go. Then I started collecting the 12-inch figures, and the 12-inch figures were cool because then I could make the characters I didn't have. So I made so many Real American Hero characters, and it was so much easier because if you collect, you know, the 12-inch figures, some of them will come with stuff that the Hasbro one, some of them will come with stuff that you might not want for that character that you want to make. So you just end up with all this extra, you know, costumery that you can use, you know, with other characters, you know. So I kept doing that for a while. And so, like, all through the 90s, like, I wasn't big on Ninja Force. I know you love Ninja Force. I like the I liked them in the comics because Storm Shadow was awesome. And I got the, remember the, what was that, the 10th anniversary, or no, Hall of Fame, that's what they were called. The Hall of Fame 12-inch figures. I got Snake Eyes, Storm Shadow, and Major Blood.
I have that Snake Eyes.
Yeah, with the big metal, I think they did two of them, but one of them had a ballistic face mask on. And he had like a chopping action. It was weird. It was like, oh, okay. But he looked cool. So we were like, yep, let's get him.
Jeez. So the 12-inch guys weren't spared the...
My one was.
No, boobs. Not at all.
My one was because he came with some kind of missile launcher thing that was like, that was his feature. You know?
Yeah. You're talking about the other one. Yeah. With the knives.
I remember being upset because I went back to go and get Stalker and he wasn't there. At game. Steve, at game. That's where I found him. At game. Random.
Wonderful. To add a bit of context to perhaps the inexplicable G.I. Joburg love for the Ninja Force, we were the right age for that stuff to really hit. We were kids in 92 and 93. I mean, like young kids. I was 7 and 8. So it just goes to show that that stuff worked. Hasbro's marketing team knew what the expected target market wanted at that time.
Yeah.
I mean, we were the kids that just gobbled that shit up because, you know, like anyone who had been around in the early days of G.I. Joe knew better, but they were in a rapidly shrinking minority.
Yeah.
We wanted Ninja Turtles. We wanted neon colors. We wanted guys that could chop bricks in half. According to the commercial, I don't know.
I can't say
I've had success with my Ninja Force slice, but anyway.
I had Ninja Turtles, though. Me and my best friend, that was what we were collecting. So we were collecting Ninja Turtles and the Kenner Batman figures from the movies. So we weren't really we weren't looking at G.I. Joe like we used to. Like the Batmobile from that. I remember having I had the Bat ski boat, and that just like to me was so awesome because it was in the movie. You know what I mean? So like in comparison to what you were seeing with the Joes, a lot of the toys didn't match everything that was on the cartoon at the time. And I didn't get into the comics until I was an adult. So, well, not really. I had like 2 or 3 issues, maybe a little bit more from like the tail end of the Marvel run when like Ninja Force was showing up, when I think I had the issue when Cobra Commander, Snake Eyes, and Destro, they're like taking off their masks on the cover. You know what I'm talking about?
Oh, yeah.
Yeah. I remember that.
I'm pretty sure I had that.
Though that must have been a back issue because that is quite a vintage one, if I'm not mistaken.
Yeah.
It's in the 50s.
It's in the 50s, yeah.
Hey, but 2 South Africans and a Yank, and we are all 3 of us quite deprived when it comes to early G.I. Joe toys and stuff.
Oh, yeah. It was just because we didn't – I know for me, I didn't really know outside of the toys and the cartoon that there were comics. And, you know, I didn't even know the full breadth of – you know, G.I. Joe stuff, other than what my friend who seemed to have everything, what he had. When I stopped with the 12-inch figures, it wasn't until Rise of Cobra and Resolute that I even started paying attention to Joe's. I met my wife now and her son, who's now my stepson, and he had a box of just beat up G.I. Joe's, but he had a couple that weren't in bad shape, like the Twins and Spirit and whatnot, and I'm like, dude, do you realize what you have? He didn't have any idea at all because Dad just gave them to him. So I was like, let's get into this so I can teach him more about G.I. Joe. And we started getting the
DVDs. Let me take these off of your hands.
Come here, son.
I mean, the cool thing was I definitely like we played together, you know, because he never really played with this stuff. Apparently, like the way his dad was, he just had the toys, but he never showed him what you would do with them, so he just chewed on them. You know, he was about 4 or 5 when I met him. So I was like, dude, these weapons go to these guys. You know, these are ninjas. Make them do cool stuff. You know, let's make them go on missions and stuff. You know, and I started hunting down older figures wherever we could find them, and then all of a sudden, Resolute came first, right?
Correct.
The weird. Remember, there was that weird trailer where I think Duke and Roadblock were like in the jungle fighting Cobra Troopers, and then all of a sudden they're pinned down and they're like, we're sending the ninja. And they're like, we have a ninja. And, you know, Snake Eyes comes in and dispatches the bad guys. And I was like, wow. And I didn't even know that a toy line was coming based on those. And then all of a sudden, there's the toy line, you know, mixed in with the 25th anniversary. And from that point, You know, it was a wrap. Rise of Cobra showed up. It was a wrap because the vehicles were insane. There were a lot of good, you know, figures. Even if you don't like the movie, which I didn't really like the movie, it just, it's like the idea was, some of the ideas were there with them, you know, globe hopping and whatnot, globe trotting, whatever. But the spirit was missing, you know? It didn't really feel like G.I. Joe.
But, you know.
But it's funny how it's like a sore spot for like all of us that really enjoyed G.I. Joe growing up.
It's like when I tell people I love G.I. Joe, that's immediately what they think of, that stupid movie.
Oh, yeah. We are cursed to endure that stamp of mediocrity. But, Ewart, in a sentence, can you pitch me, and this is an exercise in restraint, I guess. In one sentence, can you pitch me a winning formula for a G.I. Joe movie?
Oh, wow. OG 13.
What is your priority? Numero uno priority.
OG 13. Bam. OG 13. That's it. Start at the beginning. I did a video where I tried to lay it out. You know, they should have, and I mentioned it in the what I would have done if I ran G.I. Joe, the brand. The movie.
You would have done a lot. I listened to that. That episode is filled with amazing ideas, ambitious ones too. I mean, budget, buddy, budget.
Yeah, I know, right? It's true. It's very true. But I think some of the stuff could be done given the budget that they have or that they've had.
Right.
You know, some of it could be done. And then, like, you know, from the return that you would get from doing some of that stuff, you could expand. But, like, with the movie, start at the beginning. Start off with, you know, a smaller group. Start off with some kind of conflict that explains why you need to build this special, you know, team to deal with this threat posed by whoever the proto-Cobra would be, you know? And then kind of transition into that first issue, you know, as a film. And I'm telling you, it would sell. It's not going to be super expensive because the costumes don't have to be insanely, you know, crazy. They just got to be basic. And it needs to take place in that time period. I don't know why so many of these directors and writers are so afraid to just write the story in the time period that it's supposed to represent. It's like they can't get past the fact that the Joes are kind of a Cold War era, the original Joes are a Cold War era, like, relic somewhat, and you should be building from that, you know? Because there's conflict. It's not like we don't have we have a shortage of conflict. We still have issues that, you know, you can use them for. But, yeah, it's just strange to me. Like, I would have it in the 80s, you know, 80s music, have a synthwave style, orchestral synthwave style score. You know, it would fit. I think it would work. And then each subsequent film would be closer and closer to the modern age. And then, you know, when you get to your Pursuit of Cobra, if that's what you want to do, you're in the modern age, near future tech, the designs look all Call of Duty-ish, or if that's what you want, or Tom Clancy-ish, if that's what you want, and you know it's modern, so now you can go nuts with all the tech and all the effects and the blah 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 and the this and the that and the nanotech and the. I don't understand why they haven't done it. It's like they overthink the smallest details, you know.
I think this sentiment is rising, though. You are a man after my own heart. I couldn't have put it better. I have a love for not only the toys and the characters, but the era that they were set in. It was such a product of its time. Mm-hmm. And you're absolutely right. Setting in the Cold War adds intrigue, adds a kind of veneer of like retro cool.
Oh, yeah.
You know, everything's just so much more fun in another era. You can kind of play with it. You can move in and out of actual historical events.
Exactly.
So history buffs, you know, get their Easter eggs. You know, one of the most fun examples I can think of was that little glimmer of hope in the X-Men franchise called First Class.
Oh, Lord.
Situating the mutants right in the middle of the Cuban Missile Crisis, you know, a standoff between the Soviet Navy and the American Navy. And right in the middle, you've got a small group of superpowered mutant individuals, like basically on the cusp of World War III.
Uh-huh.
That's exciting. Yeah. If you do something similar with G.I. Joe and their conflict with Cobra, it's the sort of epicenter of a huge struggle between the superpowers. Oh, man, the stakes are awesome.
Yeah.
You can build it around real-world events. It is just...
It should be
enough. Hopefully there are enough of us out there who find favor with this kind of idea that it eventually finds its way into some producer's ear hole.
Exactly.
Yeah, well, the thing is as well, I mean, if you want a proof of concept, you don't have to look much further than The Phantom Pain, the most recent Metal Gear.
Because
that is set in the 80s. And it plays like a Saturday morning cartoon. You know, they're using a lot of sophisticated technology for their era, but even by some standards, it's sophisticated for our era.
Exactly.
And it's got all of those little things put together in it. I mean, the game itself plays like a TV series.
It does.
So, and I I can immediately relate to that.
To that working.
Yeah, but I'm on the same page as you guys, but I think you know that already.
And by the same token, why I bemoan not getting Power Man and Iron Fist, Heroes for Hire, set in the 70s, late 70s, early 80s.
I was thinking about that.
Come on. Power Man with a tiara and a big collar. Like, what? What?
Well, what they should have done.
Missed opportunity.
They should have
so much more colorful than what they did with Luke Cage.
Yeah.
Which,
oh man, that was a whole nother story right there. Oh my god.
You want to build it into what is it, the Defenders?
Yeah.
The Defenders.
Which it shouldn't
integrate
even,
them into Doctor Strange's world.
It shouldn't have even been because they're not going to be in Doctor Strange's world. They're just going to be, you know, kind of street level super team that, you know, kind of resembles the. To them, it resembles the Defenders, but in reality, it resembles the Heroes for Hire. That's what it should have been.
Yeah.
But instead, I don't know why, because the Defenders have nothing to do with what they're building towards. They're completely different. It's like a batshit insane. You know, if you guys come together, the universe or the world will end. And then it's like, you know, later on, you find out if they come together. You'll allow this thing to happen that will destroy the universe. It's like, it's nuts when you go back and read those old Defenders books, you know? But, and it's remembered as the team that did not work. Like, that's how Iceman constantly, you know, remembers or reminisces about the team. You know, remember that time we were on that team that didn't work? He doesn't even name it sometimes, you know? They just drop the concept that it did not work because it was so disastrous.
Yeah.
But, yeah, I don't know. I'll check it out.
That's a TV show I want to see.
Yeah, exactly.
It sounds more interesting. Team that did not work. I'm not talking about the Fantastic Four. Thank you very much. But how they've screwed that up.
Oh,
my goodness.
Yeah. Because they're afraid of this same concept, and that's the,
you know,
the things
for
taking
a time,
place in
Victor Von Doom was the uber-villain of the Marvel Universe. He was the numero uno bad dude.
He was.
Everyone's most challenging test was to come up against Dr. Doom.
That's true.
Yeah.
That's true. And you can
Why do they keep cocking him up?
Yeah, they make him very, I don't want to say the word beatable, but yeah, he is kind of like, they've kind of
it
made it that.
Sucks. They never nail his backstory, his concept, his look sucks.
Yeah, they're afraid because he's so OP'd. It's ridiculous. I mean, he uses science and magic. He's always delving into something to make him more powerful. Yeah, it's weird. But I think the biggest issue they have with that franchise and some of those other ones is that they're afraid of period. I mean, he's very much a 60s mod supervillain. You know what I mean? Like, with him running, he's like a James Bond villain on steroids. You know what I mean? Like,
But with an element of like 16th century Europe. I mean, wearing that extremely iconic
suit of armor
with the bolts and the eye slits. I mean, it's supposed to be super sophisticated, and yet he goes with this very like rustic aesthetic, which looks, I mean, that is Dr. Doom. You can't mess with that.
Yeah.
Otherwise, it just isn't Dr. Doom. Yeah. You want these scarred, like putrefied, disgusting eyes clearly visible inside this, you know, set into this extremely heavy looking formidable mask.
Yeah, I agree.
With that mouthpiece with that sort of square or rectangular design, like robotic teeth. I mean, come on, just get it right once.
The thing is with Doctor Strange, with Doctor Doom, and relates to Doctor Strange is that when you watch the Doctor Strange movie, you know, he's ultimately defeated by his hubris and sort of rebuilds himself, but he doesn't really lose that ego, but it's just that he channels a lot of that towards doing good things. I mean, he was a doctor, you know, and he wanted to ultimately do the right thing. There's no sort of like revenge or darkness in his heart. But the Doctor Doom story that I would buy is, here is this guy who actually does want to do a lot of great things, but his ego gets in the way, and that's ultimately what makes him the villain he is, because he kind of like goes, he puts his toes in the water of being bad, and then he kind of goes off fucking and just jumps in, you know.
Pretty much.
That's how I've always found him to be, because he does do some crazy stuff. I mean, in the comics, he makes deals with Mephisto, and he makes deals with Dormammu and all of them, and sometimes those deals are not because he wants to take over the world. They're just like because he's trying to save the soul of his mother, you know,
yeah,
or something like that. So he's like, he's like a good person, but he just can't get past himself, you know, and that makes him, I think that makes him a very, very challenging character to write on screen as just a villain, you know.
I think it's,
whereas in the comic,
if they pick the right story, and it's the same thing we're talking about with G.I. Joe as a film. There's so much history. There's so much groundwork that's already been laid. Instead of some Hollywood writer jumping in saying, I can do a better story than what all this history of G.I. Joe has laid before him.
Yeah, it's like, you know, I watched G.I. Joe once. I got this.
Yeah, like, why? What makes him better than Larry Hama or better than the collective of writers that have written all this, you know, the 155 issues of the original Marvel run? What makes guy better? You know what I mean? Like, you need to respect what came beforehand and, you know, pay tribute to that instead of coming up with some weird, like, every single movie felt like an episode of the cartoon, just like, you know, some guy just went nuts with it. You know what I mean? In a bad way, not in a good way. And it's like, you could have just taken an arc from the comics, an early arc, and then, you know, another arc from later on. You have your episode one and your episode two, and it's simple. But I don't know. It's just they don't respect the source material enough, you know? I mean, at least with Marvel, we're seeing that they respect the source material enough to build on that for their cinematic versions. And G.I. Joe needs the same thing. I think the toy line kind of is starting to fall into that, too, where it's like they're listening to the fan base, and they're not providing the fan base with a product. You know, like before, they used to provide us with the product, and then the fan base would be like, oh my God, this is awesome. Now it's like, hey guys, what should we make? And you got all these guys who have no fucking clue. They just want to buy shit. And they're like, you know, make this. Yeah, make this. Yeah, make this. And then they're like, okay, they want boring G.I. Joes. They want hit and run that's gray, all gray. You know what I mean? Like, they want, you know, Bazooka in blue. What? Why? He's not a name. He's not.
I don't understand that.
Like, and they and
Smurf people, Patrol.
Exactly, you know what I mean? And everyone buys it. So, like, people don't understand how criticism works both ways. If you criticize the folks that you love, that give you something that you love, when they go off the rails, then they understand that they went off the rails. If you never actually say anything to them to let them know that they went off the rails, then you're going to keep getting shit from them. But, you know, we get these fans that they criticize, but then they keep buying. So it's like, at some point, you got to take responsibility for the fact that you have shaped the problems that we're facing with these lines. You know, if you see them as problems, you know, the things you don't like, you've kind of, you know, it's like a self-fulfilling prophecy. You just, you know, or what is it? Cycle of violence. You just kept it going.
Yeah, we've all got this sickness in us that compels us to buy anything with the beautiful, bold G.I. Joe lettering stitched across the top.
Not I.
You know, I shudder to think that if I saw the Smurf Patrol in the flesh, I might think to myself,
no,
that's a kind of cool Firefly, and the other guys, put them on a boat, maybe.
No.
I'll put them on a fucking,
you gotta be stronger.
G.I. Joe repurposed Moray. You know, they did that blue one, and then they did the swirly camo one, which
you gotta fight,
sadly,
that.
I own.
You gotta fight
put
it.
Put them inside a Barracuda, man.
You gotta
fight
that. Yeah,
I'll never see the light of day.
You gotta fight that stuff.
But you see, that's the thing, like, on that same train of thought, they went and put two blue figures with a really amazing Firefly.
Yeah, he was pretty
good.
You're the worst. I was kidding. You're actually finding a justification for scooping up that piece of garbage three-pack.
No.
Ladies and gentlemen of the audience, please vote with your dollars. If you do not think something is good, do not support it.
Exactly.
That's what I want to say.
Maybe then Hasbro will yank the chain on G.I. Joe altogether because they'll be like, whatever we do, it's not making the kind of money it made for us in the 80s when we all built up mansions.
True.
So forget that. Let's make more Mr. Potato Head.
No, dude, that's what I'm trying to say. Like, Hasbro is putting this really amazing Firefly with a blue bazooka and a blue, I don't know if it's Dusty or Hit and Run, because I honestly don't care.
Yeah, it's Dusty.
You want to tell me that Hasbro, like, is not smoking crack? You know, because, like...
No, bro, they're smoking way more expensive stuff than crack.
Just, they must be fucking high, man, because I don't know how, in their collective sort of marketing mentality, they think that that's going to work. The only thing that makes sense to me is that the blue color scheme is a mistake and they had to solve that problem. And then they put those two blue figures in with Firefly. It's the only thing I can think of because it's the only thing that makes sense. And like you said, you know, we do like, and I always say, you vote with your money. You know, you don't, if you don't buy it, then they do realize something is wrong. And I have not bought it. I haven't bought it on principle. I'm on eBay looking for the Firefly, but I'm not going to buy that three pack on principle. And it's been in front of me for a fairly decent price a few times.
Oh yeah. They're all on clearance now. Like all that stuff's on clearance at Toys R Us. It's weird, you know, cause it just feels like there are a lot of figures that could have, they could have filled that slot with that they didn't already do, you know, figures from the infamous concept case that they could have put in that three pack.
Yeah.
And that would have made a lot of collectors happy, you know?
Well, who did they miss?
There was a rock and roll
version 2.
Yeah, it was a rock and roll, a new rock and roll. It was pretty much Dusty's, the Pursuit of Cobra Dusty without all his gear. And then they kind of tweaked the vest a little bit. And he had camo pants, the armored upper body, and the cap, like the version 2 from the vintage. Let's see who else. There was a really cool clutch. There was, there's still, this is actually from Retaliation. Do you remember those red ninjas with the zipline stuff? Like, not the ones that they released, but the ones in the actual film.
Yes, I know what you do. Yeah, those ones. Those were cool.
Somehow they never released them. I have pictures of them and everything. I've put them up in one of my videos. They just forgot that that shit existed, you know?
City Strike Scarlet.
Yeah, City Strike Scarlet. A lot of people want that figure, and it's like something they're just never going to do. Maybe they will. Who knows? But it feels like something they won't do. Or let me see. They had all those Dreadnought troopers, remember, with the hockey masks and the weird armor and stuff? They looked like Mad Max characters and stuff. They had different versions of the Joe troopers that were kind of mixed with the Steel Brigade aesthetic. Yeah, there were a bunch of figures, man, like that actually would have been, you know, a change. I mean, when you look hard enough, you can tell.
I think there was a Target as well, if I'm not mistaken.
Yeah, they did. There were enough figures in that concept case that they could have given us, you know, any couple of those guys instead of repainting or remolding, you know, those characters in colors that don't even make sense from a strategic point of view, you know. And I know, like, a lot of collectors like to, you know, fashion show up their Joes and have them match the vehicle and all that shit. And I'm kind of like, you know, I don't get down with that stuff sometimes. I'm like, I get it, you know. But if you think about it, like, when you look at the original Hydrofoil, the, what was the name of the driver? Was he an eel or was he a moray? He was
Lamprey.
A Lamprey. There you go. The Lamprey did not match the vehicle because he's the driver. You're supposed to know. He's supposed to stand out a little bit. Some of the characters are supposed to look like they, you know, they do the function, but they're not supposed to look like, you know, I coordinated my costume today with my, you know, with the vehicle I'm driving. Like, come on, guys. Like, that's not the way it's supposed to work. Even with, like, the pilots, too, you know. You've got a white plane or a gray plane and the pilot's wearing olive green. You know, it's like, the two things don't always have to coincide, but you hear that a lot in the collector circles, man. Everything is color coordinated, and it's like, ah, come on. So now we have blue, you know, blue Bazooka and blue Dusty to go with whatever other blue characters you feel like putting together your blue team, you know. I mean, it's cool. Don't get me wrong. They're toys, so we're supposed to have fun. But I still feel like it was a missed opportunity for other, you know, characters in the mythos to have been realized, and they just didn't bother, you know. But
well, I mean, another mystery I still can't solve as well with Hasbro is that, okay, so they've got figure subscription service. The figure subscription service is like, I think it's three times the price of the Mattie figure subscription service. Mm-hmm. And G.I. Joe's are smaller toys, mm-hmm. okay? So they're essentially charging us the same price. Actually, they're more, hey? Because the Mattie collector stuff, I think, is about $50. Yep. And G.I. Joe figure subscription stuff is about $60, depending on the figure. So they're charging us more for less plastic, and a lot of the times it's retreading. It's not even like cool stuff, like the stuff that was in that concept case.
Yeah.
You know, if Hasbro put in their full collective sort of might into doing that properly and did the model the same way as the Mattie collector model, it would be great. But they don't. They have some archaic model for their subscription service. Nobody can afford it, really. I mean, it's like $300, and then you still have to pay, I think, something every month or whatever. It's insane. It's just dumb.
A lot of people are buying into it, though. That's the thing, you know. It's like what we said earlier. You gotta vote with your wallet. If you don't agree, don't back them just so you can have the new shit, you know. Because a lot of people, it's about having the new shit. I mean, and don't get me wrong. Mm-hmm. I want new stuff. I want cool new stuff, but what I'm seeing versus what they're asking for, it doesn't match up at all, you know? Like
I agree.
Did you see the new stuff, the Battle Force 2000 stuff they're doing? I'm like, wow.
Oh, my word, dude. I mean, all I said to that is when I saw the pictures the first time, and Steve will probably remember me saying this, is like, the one thing the figure subscription service got right is that they still shit. The Battle Force 2000 are still crap. I mean, they nailed it.
Yeah. Consistency there.
Yeah, you'd think that's they some would.
Consistent shit.
You'd think they would try to redesign them in a way that would make them palatable. So whatever it was that was missing the first time, now you put that in there. You know, you make them look better, make them more.
Oh, but you would think they come with an extra gun each. So not only do you get the laughable weapon that they came with originally, which at great expense they've managed to recreate the molds of.
Uh-huh.
But you get, you know, an extra pack in. So, like, more accessories. Yay!
I know, right?
I don't know. And they all look the same. They seem to all have the same faces.
I just don't. I don't get how a lot of what I see with the subscription service is just a lot of them retreading things that you always hear the fan base say they hated when Hasbro did it the first time. Because, you know, like, the subscription service, I want to say it's run mostly by a smaller group that gets permission. It's like partnered with Hasbro to have them make the molds based on approved tooling that they can use. They only have so much tooling that they're allowed to mix and match to make the figures. But they keep on, like, why do we have so many neon figures and so many, you know, the weird bright colors that don't match and, like, why? Why are we still getting that when all you ever hear is the 90s were terrible? Neon, neon, neon.
Well, the 90s are all we're left with. Come on. Yeah, like,
exactly.
Battle Android Trooper version 2.
Yeah.
That was my bad. But I have been corrected on this before, and I'm not going to let it plague us anymore.
Uh-huh.
The Battle Force 2000 set, I believe, is the convention set.
Okay.
Yeah,
okay.
It's distinct from the biggest subscription service.
Cool.
Yeah, but it's made by the same people.
I think it's the same group. Yeah, you're right.
I've been wrapped on the knuckles.
That's right. Yeah, somebody corrected us, but I was like, okay, so big deal because you're still giving the same asshole money.
Best JD, by the way, and you know, I appreciate the correction because personally, I don't see them as distinct things. I see them as exclusive figures I will never own nor ever want to own.
True.
Because there's always something a little off about them.
Yeah, I agree. You know,
it's produced by a third party, and power to them. I'd really like to be supportive of anyone who's able to scrounge together the dough, the chutzpah, you know, the gumption to actually make figures and market them, fill holes in people's collections.
Exactly.
But they always feel a little off, like, you know, they're all kitbashed and, you know, you have customizers blaring in your ear that, oh, I could have done a better job. And, you know, those parts are okay, but these parts are better. And I'm like,
exactly.
Oh, all I want is official products that is sort of above and beyond reproach.
Yeah.
Like when Hasbro puts something out, it's either monumentally shit or they get it right.
Yeah.
Like there's no gray area. It's like either Smurf Brigade or Resolute City Strike Snake Eyes.
Yeah, it's true.
You end up being the proud owner of three blowtorches because he just happened to be a packing figure with Destro and or Leatherneck or whoever else you were getting in that line.
Rockmaster.
Yeah, they fucked you, Paul.
Yeah, they tried really hard to get rid of.
But the thing is that the way what they're doing now just fucks you worse.
Yeah.
You know.
What a fucking. Thanks, Hasbro. Fucking me since I was 4 years old.
Yeah, but at least they used lube then.
I know, right? Well, back
then. It was pillow talk.
Back then it was.
No, back when I was 4, I wanted it.
Wow.
Okay, this is horrific. We're going to lose some listenership that little passage of play.
It got real dark real quick.
I'm going to start wrapping this up because, hey, man, life. Yeah. I'd like to say I'm a night owl, but to be honest, I really enjoy my sleep. So, any closing remarks? I know we've been pulling a lot of strings here. Let's try and draw the bag together. Well,
can you guys give us what? Because I've done mine in my video about what I would do with the Hasbro brand. What would you guys? Some key things that you guys each would wanna or together would want to see if you could influence or change the way things are being done. If you were in charge of the brand, what would you do? Key things, maybe four key things.
Steven's spoken a lot, so I'll start. I would first and foremost, I'd implement a strategy that targets the adult collectors. Instead of trying to drop the figures into toy stores, because that doesn't seem to be working for Hasbro. And I would refine the subscription service, even going as far as to maybe make an online Hasbro or Hasbro online store where you can buy G.I. Joe products from them directly, which would give me as a brand a lot more control on as to what is released and will get, allow me to be more sort of experimental and do cool stuff.
A
good example at the moment is the DC Direct stuff. Even though DC Direct doesn't always make the most stellar quality figures, the fact that Steven has a giant Batwing in his house and I have a giant Batmobile,
I do too.
Something I never thought I would have again,
two-seater.
Is testament.
Yeah.
So that's the first thing I would do. Secondly, I would actually if we're going to go modern era, I would re-release all the modern era figures and I would do them in the same respective years as they were done in. So, for example, I would release the original, like kind of what the 25th anniversary was doing and then sort of stopped doing, but I would start off with the original 13. So I'd start off with, okay, I know it's 82, but I'd go with 83, then I'd go 84, then I'd go 85. 86 and release the waves like that, they release those waves.
That would be awesome.
And I would stagger the wave release. It wouldn't just be like one wave. Okay, here's the whole wave. You know, throw your wallets at us. I would stagger the waves. It would be like a portion of that wave in the beginning of the year, a portion in the middle, and a portion at the end with something cool like a vehicle or something to look forward to. I think those are the three major things. And then yes, I would if I could. I would either get G.I. Joe to be a Netflix TV series, not so that it can be gritty and full of sex and boobs and whatever, but so that it can have investors who are more concerned about the final product than they are about the bottom line, which is the feeling I get from Netflix.
Yeah.
And it would I would build up its brand identity from that, you know, and do weird meta things like have adverts for the toys in the episodes and things like that, you know, just as like a throwback.
That'd be awesome.
But I mean, this is just off the top of my mind. I'm just being crazy right now.
Yeah.
But that's three things. I can't even think of a fourth thing that right now is. I suppose maybe if I was running Hasbro right now and I was running the G.I. Joe division, I would probably create a Twitter and a Facebook account and maybe update my Collectors Club website so that it doesn't look like it was made in the 90s. Just a thought.
There you go. It helps.
Yeah, because, yeah, wow, that website's old, yo.
Yeah, it is. What about you, Steven? So you can get your rest.
Oh, thank you, darling. I'm going to contradict my fellow South African right out of the gate.
Okay.
And get controversial on y'all.
Uh-oh.
And say that if I was calling the shots, I would never re-release another character again. Oh, no, wow. More Dukes, no more Snake Eyes, no more Scarlet, no more Destro. I want a 9 to 15 figure wave or series released every single year
with new sculpts
on the classic cards with painted artwork,
uh-huh,
that made you feel like you felt when you first saw those beautiful cards on pegs.
Uh-huh.
Make new characters with new specialties and compelling file cards that integrate into your G.I. Joe world because they carry the same lineage, parentage,
yeah,
as the old stuff.
He says contradict, but I don't think it means what he thinks it means. Carry on.
Oh, piss off. You want to see every single old wave re-released again?
No. What I'd like to see is modernized. Like,
I don't want any more rehash.
I hear you, but what I'm getting at is
you said if I had it now, if I had the brand now, so I'm playing it on the fact that, okay, cool, this is like, it would be a complete, like, sort of, excuse the term, but like whitewash of it, you know, like completely bleach, uh-huh, and just do it again. And then it would give us options for us to release new characters. But it would, of course, be amazing card art. It would still be the vintage packaging.
I don't want any more overlap, Paul. I don't want to be rebuying another Scarlet, another Duke, another Cobra Commander. I want
new stuff,
new characters in the style of the old. I'm not saying go back to vintage O-ring style. No, keep the modern era style. These are fantastic figures with incredible detail, removable weapons, knives that sheath. I mean, all the design cues are spectacular, but I want to recapture that lightning in the bottle, that magic of within one wave having someone on the ground as a mortar soldier, bam, and then an astronaut, bam, and then a deep sea diver, bam, and then a guy who, I don't know, goes goes ballooning over the Sahara. I mean, like, whatever. Just
new
mix
stuff.
It up. Don't give me a wave of green dudes that look like they stepped out of Call of Duty. I feel so uninspired by, like, and I'm sure, yeah, this is going to get your back up, Ewart, but, you know, a bunch of, like, realistic, read, boring Green Army men. G.I. Joe had a place for that.
Yeah.
But occupying the peg next to Hit and Run was Astro Viper. Okay.
Yeah. Yep.
And Toxo Viper to his left.
Yeah.
So, like, your play pattern was never limited by what jaded collectors constantly just gobble up.
That's true.
Mm.
Your play pattern was only limited by your own imagination, because you could have the astronauts and you could have the general and you could have the helicopter pilots.
Yeah.
So create new characters with good file cards, spectacular card art, and I will eat that. And do it in limited runs. I'm happy with 13, as few as 9 new characters in a year.
Yeah.
That's how we used to get it back in the old days, and we were better for it.
That's true.
We treasured each and every one. Each new purchase, each new toy was like unwrapping that Wonka bar and finding a golden ticket, man.
I agree.
Yeah, well, and the accessories better be there too, the cool accessories.
Of course.
Yes. Rehab accessories, just getting once again, Green Army Man with, like, he's got about 15 guns packed with him. But I'm so uninspired by having an enormous arsenal. Just goes back in the pile of like black firearms. Oh, here's another shotgun, another assault rifle, another, you know, spring-loaded bazooka.
Yeah.
Okay, those guys go in the bin. But yeah, man, make the accessories fit the character's specialty.
It's like the make line. Them unique.
The accessories were every bit as a selling point as the card art and the figure, the character, and the bio.
Yeah, it's like the line in Training Day, that the weapon that you choose defines you. You got to have weapons that do match the character and their specialties. You know what I mean? It can't just be random. And that's what we've been getting. Like random weapons that have come with 50 different characters. Like Retaliation was full of that shit. Continue.
And here's a novel thought. Uh-huh. Some characters don't even have weapons.
There you go.
I mean, what? Torpedo? He's got fins. He's got a backpack and he's got a spear gun. Okay, spear gun's a weapon. But, Breaker. What? He doesn't have a gun?
There you go.
My mind is blown. Like, it is conceivable to have personnel who do not pack, an entire arsenal.
That's true.
Mm-hmm.
Cool. What else?
Yeah.
What else? You got three more slots.
Oh, I think I've spoken enough, to be honest. You can spread that concept over three if you want. But
There we go.
I suppose I could talk a bit about what I would want the media to reflect in terms of G.I. Joe.
Uh-huh.
Maybe if everything was integrated like it was back in G.I. Joe's heyday, the comic books would actually be selling the toys primarily.
Exactly.
That kind of synergy, I mean, maybe adult collectors bemoan that. Maybe they know when exactly they're reading an issue that is selling them the, I don't know, the Badger, the Brawler, and the Battle Wagon. It's like, oh, okay.
Yeah.
Three new vehicles.
But the comic was always very cute with that, because it almost used to, like, almost rip that off. You know, like...
Well, if he was being tongue-in-cheek or not, I love that.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah.
I watch cartoons because they depict the toys that I can play with.
Yeah.
I read the comics because I could act out those adventures with the toys that were in my hands.
Exactly.
So those toy selling exercises that some issues seem devoted to, they're all right by me.
Yeah, I agree.
Yeah.
So if IDW and Hasbro were to reaffirm their relationship a bit, and it wasn't just a case of using a license because the characters are compelling and you've got a readership that wants to lap this stuff up, and actually made it a useful exercise to promote what was on shelves at that time.
Yeah.
I mean, case in point, the Resolute figures that you are now fawning over weren't available when the webisodes were going out, when this stuff was hot news.
Exactly.
There were no toys to back it up.
You're right.
It was a very piss-poor bit of timing on Hasbro's part, and they need that synergy that they had in the 80s to come back, to reignite our love for the line, particularly if they're like doing something risky, like branching out and creating new characters and new specializations and new play patterns. You need a comic book to support that.
Yeah, or
it would be too much of a stretch to have a cartoon as well, but hell, if you're really wanting to rip the roof off, the three-barreled approach is,
cartoon, comic,
gold.
And toys. Yeah,
cartoon, figures, and comic book.
Yeah. That'd be awesome.
Is that enough speaking for you, brother?
That is enough.
I need to rest my voice. You know?
Yeah, this was awesome. This was awesome.
So quickly, if you would like to punt your YouTube channel and any other ventures that you'd like to get out there, you're on our podcast now, brother.
Cool. Thank you. Find me on YouTube. It's Strident with a Y, Strydent. And you can find me on Facebook. It's the same thing, Strident with a Y. There's another Strident with a I. It's a band, but that's not me. It's the one with the Y. You can find us, my fan page on Facebook, Strident with a Y. And that's pretty
much it. Join the group.
Yeah, join the group. Yeah, we do.
Join the movement.
We try to geek out.
Yeah, the movement.
We try to geek out a lot. These days, I don't know what's going on. People seem a little bit kind of chill. But, you're welcome to join us and geek out. I'm on there most of the time, so I'm trying to throw up things, topics for us to talk about. So, feel free to join.
Uwert is extremely enthusiastic. Every single new member gets a very warm welcome. So if you want to bathe in the love, join Strident's Facebook group. It's awesome. And join T.I. Joburg as well.
Awesome.
This is wonderful. The collaboration, the mixing of ideas, even if it's just for no other reason than to chat it up and, you know, have a laugh about it amongst ourselves.
Yep.
It's worth it. But our North American companion, Cujo, is confident that this stuff eventually will find the ears of the people that can make it happen for us. So, yep, Strident and G.I. Joburg, we are going to be running the G.I. Joe show, man.
Yeah, I hope
Watch this space.
I hope so.
A couple of years, we'll be calling the shots.
Oh, yeah, Fenris Company toys all the way. Watch.
Yes, sir.
Well, it's been real, guys.
And good night, everybody.
Yep. Adios. Peace outside, guys.
Cool, man. Well, I...